Good morning, children. So welcome to another class of chemistry. And we had started the previous chapter of, that is chapter 2, that is elements, compounds and mixtures. So we will be dealing with the same chapter today, and this is part 2, okay? So in the previous lesson, children, what did we discuss? We discussed that what are elements, right? Now, what I told you about elements, that element is what? It is a substance which is made up of same type of atoms. So I gave you the example of copper element. That is a copper element. It is a mass of copper will be made up of all atoms of copper. Okay. It will be made up of atoms of copper. So atom is the smallest part. Then comes the elements. Okay. So elements are, they are the simplest form of matter. Okay. And they cannot be split into some more simpler forms. Like water, if we split, water can be split into hydrogen and oxygen. Okay. But elements of copper cannot be split into any smaller form or substance. Okay. So these we saw. We also saw that what are metals, metalloids and non-metals. Okay. Metalloids, I told you, they are called semi-metals because they have the properties of both metals and non-metals. Okay. We also saw that the symbols of different elements. Now, I told you about the common or Latin or Greek name out of on which their names are given. That is, short name or abbreviations are given. All these things I told you, that is hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, all symbols we understood. And I also gave you some Latin names which were not given in the book. That is for silver, for lead, for gold, for sodium and for potassium. Also, I gave you the Latin or Greek names. Okay, so that you can understand why that particular symbol is given. Okay. Now, we also dealt with the molecular formula of an element. How the molecular formula of an element is given. That is, what is the molecule of an element? It comprises of the same kind of atoms. For example, a molecule of oxygen. It will naturally have two oxygen atoms. Similarly, a molecule of hydrogen will be having two hydrogen atoms. Molecule of helium has one atom of helium. Now, I told you, why helium has only one molecule and that of oxygen has two. Now that depends upon means its existence, means the molecule in what form or how many atoms of a particular element combines so that it can exist freely in the nature. Okay, in nature oxygen cannot remain as one O. Okay, it cannot exist. This is not stable. But whenever two oxygen atoms combine to form a molecule of oxygen, it is stable. It can exist in the atmosphere or in the nature. Similarly, helium. Helium doesn't need another helium molecule or rather another helium atom to exist in nature. It can, an element of or the atom of helium can exist in nature alone also. That's why only one He. So atomicity we discussed, that is how many molecules are attached, that is the molecular formula in the molecule, how in nature, I mean in the existence, in what form it exists in nature. For example, helium, one atom can survive or remain in nature, so atomicity is one. Oxygen, two atoms has to combine to form a molecule of oxygen, so two. Similarly, phosphorus, not two. Here, four atoms of phosphorus will combine to form a molecule of phosphorus, which can be stable in nature. Similarly, sulfur, eight atoms of sulfur has to combine to remain stable in nature. Okay, one single atom or two atoms cannot combine to remain stable in the atmosphere or in the nature. That is atomicity. Okay. So the number of atoms in a molecule is known as atomicity. Now today we'll deal with a next topic, that is compounds. Okay. Now today we'll discuss about compounds. So what do we mean about this? What are compounds all about? Okay. Two or more elements combined together in a fixed ratio to form a compound. Remember and listen very carefully, children. Two or more elements. Elements means elements have the same kind of atom. Okay, for example, element of hydrogen will be having same atoms of hydrogen. Element of oxygen is having same atoms, that is oxygen atoms. Okay, for example, bricks. Brick is a form of matter. It is having same forms, the simplest forms, that is atoms of that matter, bricks, is having all the same atoms. No different kinds of atoms. Now, here in compounds, two or more, not only two, two but more also, elements, okay, they can combine with each other in a fixed ratio, be very particular, fixed ratio to form a compound. Original properties of the constituent elements are lost and a substance with new properties are formed, okay. A compound is also known as chemical compound. Why? Because it is formed due to chemical reaction. Because, for example, they have taken the example of water, you can see. Okay. Now, you know water is a compound or a molecule of water, which is actually a compound because it is made up of two or more elements. What are the two elements? Hydrogen and oxygen are the two elements which combine in a fixed ratio. Fixed ratio means one hydrogen element, that is one atom of hydrogen will combine with 8 atoms of oxygen to form molecule of water. Okay, so here we can see one more sentence which is written. It is original properties of the constituents. That is, original properties of the constituents means, of the elements, constituent elements means, for example, water is formed by hydrogen and oxygen. Now, hydrogen and oxygen are the two elements which form water. Now, you know, hydrogen is a gas, oxygen is also a gas. But the one or the substance which is formed, it is water, it is not same as the two gases. It is water, it is liquid. So the properties are fully new. It is not the same. And why they are known as chemical compounds? Because they are formed due to chemical reactions. Okay. Now that is why they are this is what we mean about compounds. That is, means two or more elements. That is, see here, element hydrogen and element oxygen is combining in the ratio. What is the ratio? 1:8. That is, 1:8 is the mass, okay? 1:8 is the mass, and that is 1 gram of hydrogen, and 1 gram, that is, mass is always measured in grams, okay? And it is the amount of substance, okay? It is the amount of substance or amount of matter which we are talking about. Mass is what? Mass is the amount of a substance or amount of a matter which we are talking about. Though mass and weight, you don't know the difference, but mass and weight are a little bit different because mass is not affected by gravity, okay? But weight is affected by gravity. Mass here which we are talking about is due to grams, okay? Means is measured in grams and it is not affected by gravity. What is mass? Mass is the amount of a matter, a particular amount of matter. Now, here the mass of hydrogen is 1, that is 1 gram. 1 gram of hydrogen combines with 8 grams of oxygen. Now, what that does this mean? What is this thing actually means? That is, the mass of oxygen gas, okay? Listen very carefully. The mass of oxygen gas which is required to react completely with 1 gram of hydrogen means how much amount of oxygen will completely react with all the mass of hydrogen is 8. That means if 8 grams of oxygen is provided to hydrogen, then it will means completely react. Otherwise, some atoms might be free. If 8 grams of oxygen is made to mix with 1 gram of hydrogen, then it will completely react with very nicely. Okay. So if I consider that if 2 grams means 2 is 2, what will be the this mass of oxygen then? If 1 gram is of hydrogen mixes with 8 grams of oxygen, then 2 grams by mass of hydrogen will mix with how much? 8 to the 16. So 16 gram of oxygen will react completely with 2 grams of hydrogen. It goes like that. Okay. That is mass. And by volume means, that is, how many atoms are there? See, hydrogen atoms, 2 are there. So 2 hydrogen atoms will combine with 1 atom of oxygen. Okay. That is by volume. This by volume. Now, similarly, they have given one more example as carbon dioxide, which is a compound again, containing carbon and oxygen in the ratio 3:8 by mass. Means 3 grams of carbon will react completely with 8 grams of oxygen. Okay, that is the meaning. Mass by gram or kilogram generally, but we are considering here grams. So by mass 3:8. So if I consider 3 gram of carbon. So 3 gram of carbon means how much amount of oxygen it will be required to combine completely with 3 grams of carbon, that is 8 grams, okay, of oxygen will be required. So what will be produced if carbon and oxygen they mix together? They will form carbon dioxide, a molecule of carbon dioxide. So this is a, so I told you beforehand, only remember children, when I was talking about elements can be in two forms, either molecules or compounds. When they are formed from different elements, it is generally called as compound. When generally two elements of same nature are there, it is called a molecule. Okay, so actually these are all molecular compounds. That's why a molecule of water and a molecule of carbon dioxide is written, it is a molecular compound, because here a molecule is formed but two different elements are used. Here carbon dioxide has properties altogether different from carbon and oxygen. Okay, some common compounds are given in your book and their constituent elements. For example, water is formed. What are the constituent elements? Hydrogen and oxygen. Sodium chloride is made up of sodium and chlorine. Okay, common salt, sodium chloride. So you can be asked what to name the compound, means scientific, or name the chemical name of common salt. So it will be sodium chloride. Sand or silica, it is made up of silicon and oxygen. Okay, carbon dioxide, carbon and oxygen makes carbon dioxide. Okay children, now let us go to the next slide. Okay, properties of compounds. Now what do you mean by properties of compounds? The following properties are shown by all compounds. All compounds show these following properties. What are they? A compound is obtained by a chemical combination of two or more elements in a fixed ratio by mass. Means the mass will always remain in a fixed condition. For example, for carbon dioxide, which is a compound, the fixed ratio was what? 3:8. Similarly, for water, which is a compound, again a molecular compound, what is the ratio? 1:8. So fixed ratio will be always there for forming a compound. Compounds are homogeneous. Their properties are same throughout. Homogeneous means what? Means, for example, hydrogen and oxygen are mixing. So in oxygen, the amount of hydrogen in all the parts of oxygen will be same. Not there that in some portions the hydrogen amount will be more, in some portions the hydrogen amount will be less. No, hydrogen and oxygen will completely mix together and a homogeneous property or homogeneous mixture or homogeneous compound will be formed. Compounds are homogeneous, that is their properties are same throughout. Means, for example, I have taken water. Now I have taken a glass of water. Any part of the water I take from a spoon of water I take, it will be having the same properties. Not that a part of water will be having different properties, another part of the water will be having the same different properties. Not that the surface water is having a property and a lower base, that is the water which is at the base, will be having a different property. No, all the full compound will be having the same property. Any part we take, it will show the same properties. Now, it is homogeneous. Their properties are same throughout. Throughout the compound, the properties will be same. Chemical and physical properties of the compound are different from those of the constituent elements. Now, chemical constituent elements, for example, if you consider water, what are the constituent elements of water? Hydrogen and oxygen. Now, we know hydrogen and oxygen both are gases, but physically they are, means if I consider the constituent elements hydrogen and oxygen, they are gases, but when the compound is formed, it is forming a liquid. So chemical properties of the elements, constituent elements, are different from the main compound which is formed. For example, hydrogen is a combustible gas. Combustible gas means burns. It burns very easily. Okay, hydrogen burns very easily. It burns very easily, while oxygen is a supporter of combustion. What does this mean? Now, combustible gas means it burns, means hydrogen gas burns, okay? While oxygen is a supporter of combustion, means oxygen will help something to burn, but hydrogen burns itself, okay? For example, if hydrogen gas is present and if heat is produced or if heat is given, the hydrogen gas will burn. And it will, if when all the hydrogen gas is completely burnt, it will stop burning. So it is a combustible gas. It burns. Okay, combustible means it is flammable. It burns. While oxygen, if present, for example, if paper is burning, okay, and if I provide with oxygen, that paper I provide with some oxygen, what will happen? It will burn more. Why? Because oxygen is a supporter of conversion. It helps in burning. And hydrogen burns itself, okay? But their compounds, that is water, is neither combustible nor a supporter of combustion. Means water does not help in combustion, does not help in burning. So hydrogen and oxygen both are related to combustion, but water is not related. So chemical property is totally different from the constituent elements. During the formation of a compound from its elements, a certain amount of energy in the form of heat, light or electricity is absorbed or evolved. Actually, these two have a term which you will go in the higher classes and learn: exothermic reaction and endothermic reaction. Some of the reactions which when occur in nature, they take heat from outside. For example, for boiling or maybe for burning of paper, heat from outside is given, then only it is burning, okay? Or then when it is burning from, heat from outside is given and it is burning, and this is actually, and heat is evolved also. That is, what amount of heat is given, for example, when you burn a heap of leaves, okay? For example, you have dry leaves, heaps in your garden, so you collect them and you burn. When you start burning, you give a small flame. But when it fully burns, you will see that the amount of heat which is produced is much more which you gave. Okay, so heat is given out, that is evolved, okay, and absorbed. For example, ice is melting. Okay, ice is a state, it is solid matter, it melts, it will turn into liquid. So what will happen? It will absorb heat from the surroundings. In case of evolved means, it gives heat to the surrounding, that is into the environment. And absorbed means it takes heat from the heat, light or electricity from the surroundings. Okay, so during the formation of compound from its elements, what happens? Some amount of energy is either given or taken. Okay, when carbon burns, it reacts with oxygen to form a compound, it is carbon dioxide, where heat is liberated. Liberated means given out. Okay, now let us go to the next slide. Molecular formula of a compound. Now here what we will see in the molecular formula of a compound, that how these a molecule of a compound contains atoms of the constituent elements we know in a fixed ratio. Now they have to be represented in some way, isn't it? So the molecular formula of a compound, one molecule, how it looks, okay? For example, H2O, that is water. Now water is a molecule which is formed of two constituents. Now that is a compound also, but it is one molecule of that compound, okay? So one molecule of that compound is represented by H2O. Similarly, two molecules of that compound water will be represented by what? 2H2O, okay? So one molecule is represented by, in what form? One molecule of a compound is represented in which form? How is it represented? The atoms of various elements present in a molecule of a compound are in whole numbers. That is 1, 2, 3. The molecular formula of a compound can be written as follows. Write the symbols of the constituent elements. For example, what is the constituent element of water? Hydrogen and oxygen. Okay. So we will write H and O. Okay. Now write the number of atoms of each element. Now we know that what proportion of atoms they join together by volume? Two atoms of hydrogen join with one atom of oxygen. So below, just below as a subscript, I have told you about subscript, just below the, on the right hand side of the element, that is symbol of the element, we write the subscript. So what we write? H at the bottom, 2 on the right hand side of hydrogen, then O, 1. Okay, usually the subscript 1 is not written. Generally we don't write the 1, that is O1, we don't write. When we deal with the example, it will be more clear. Okay, see, now the method of writing the molecular formula of a compound is illustrated below. How we write? For example, a molecule of hydrogen chloride, it is HCl, which is an acid. Okay, what happens? One atom each of hydrogen and chlorine, they combine. So what will be the molecular formula of hydrogen chloride? H1, that is hydrogen, and chlorine also 1. So if it is 1, 1, we don't write that subscript. We write only HCl. Similarly, a molecule of water contains two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. So the molecular formula of water will be what? H2O1. So H2, two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. So one we don't write, the substrate we don't write. So H2O is the molecular formula of water. It is one molecules. H2O is a compound. But one molecule of that compound H2O is represented by H2O. If I write two molecules of the compound water, then what you will write? In front, you will write 2H2O. This I will discuss in the next slide, okay? Now, see here some compounds are given with their molecular formula. You have carbon dioxide, CO2, C1O2. So, 1 we don't write subscript, so CO2. Water, H2O1, so H2O. Nitrogen dioxide, N1, there is one atom of nitrogen and two atoms of oxygen, so NO2. Similarly, iron sulfide. Sulfide means they all have sulfur in their component. So iron and sulfide are combining to form FeS. Zinc sulfide is combining to form ZnS. Copper sulfide all have Cu1, S1, Zn1, S1, all the N1s we don't write, subscripts. That's why we have written Cus. MgS is magnesium sulfide. Calcium sulfide is CaS. Lead sulfide is PbS, that is plumbum. I told you the Latin name of lead, okay? That's why Pb. Similarly, divalent metals. Divalent means they have valency 2. Now, divalent means they can form two bonds. Okay, just you remember, you don't know about valencies now. So, I will just tell you to remember that divalent means they can form two bonds. Okay, di means 2, tri means 3. Okay, tetra means 4. So, divalent means actually divalent means they have valency 2. They have orbits. Okay, atoms have orbits. And in their last orbit, outer orbit, there are two electrons there. Okay, so two valence electrons are there, that's why divalent. So they form two bonds with the other one, that is oxide. So iron form two bonds with the oxide, so FeO. Zinc oxide also ZnO. Copper oxide CuO, all one, that's why we are not writing the subscript. Lead oxide PbO. Okay, so likewise this goes on. Now we come to mixtures. Now what do we mean by mixtures? Now children, what we saw about compound, that these compounds are always two or more elements are mixing and they are in a fixed ratio. Okay? And fixed ratio, they are in fixed ratio, that will only form a compound. But in case of mixtures, what is happening? A mixture is that form of matter in which two or more substances, that is, it might be elements or compounds, are present in any proportion. Why elements and compounds? Now, it might be elements or compounds. For example, in a mixture of salt and sand, okay? Salt is NaCl and sand is again, that is silica, silicon and that is oxygen is present, that is silica. Silicon and oxygen is present. Now, silicon and oxygen mix together to form sand. Now, salt and sand are its constituent or components. For example, a mixture of salt and sand. A mixture may be homogeneous or heterogeneous. Now, how they are homogeneous and heterogeneous depending upon the nature of the substances present therein. Generally, all liquids are mixtures which are homogeneous. For example, I am talking about a mixture of water and salt. Now, if I take a glass of water and mix a teaspoon of salt and mix it, all the salt which is there, it will homogeneously or completely mix with the water. So, from any part of that glass, we take one spoon of water, it will taste the same. Okay, so that is a homogeneous mixture. What is heterogeneous mixture? For example, I take oil and water. You will not see that the oil and water is mixing completely. Some parts of the water is having more oil, that is the surface is having more oil. The lower part of the water is not having that much oil. So what we see that the components are not mixing in equal proportions. Some part of the component is having more of a mixture, some part is having more of a substance. For example, if I consider water and oil, the upper layer will be having more oil, but the lower part of the water will be having least amount of oil. Okay? Because oil floats on the surface of water. homogeneous mixture are called solutions, okay? Because they mix solutions of sugar in water is a homogeneous mixture. For example, we take a glass of water and we give one spoon of sugar. So if we mix it, it will form an equal homogeneous mixture. Why homogeneous? Because all molecules of sugar are evenly distributed in the water. That's why. Why not heterogeneous? Heterogeneous, it would be, for example, I take one glass of water and two tablespoon of oil I give. What will happen? The oil will settle on the surface because you know oil is lighter. So it is not a homogeneous mixture. Why? Because oil is coming on the surface. It is not evenly distributed in the water, isn't it? So it is heterogeneous. In heterogeneous mixture, the particles of various components are distributed unevenly. Unevenly means they are not in even proportions. Okay, for example, I am mixing salt and sand. Now, if I mix, it is not sure that the salt will be in equal proportion in the sand. It might be in different proportions. Okay, in some part of the sand, the salt might be more. In some part of the sand, the salt might be less. Okay, now properties of mixture. All mixtures show following properties. In mixtures, the constituents may be present in any proportion. Very important, all mixtures show following properties. These properties might be present. In mixtures, the constituents may be present in any proportion. Now, there, if we saw in compound, there is bifixed mass, okay? Now, here, there is in any proportion. For example, I'm taking one tablespoon. Now, we do not know how much mass is one tablespoon, okay? Whatever amount of water we are taking, we have not measured. So, any proportion. So, for example, when your mother makes some juice, does she, for example, in this hot summer, she is making some nimbupani. Now, does she measure always that this amount of salt she is giving, this amount of water she is giving, this amount of sugar she is giving? She doesn't measure. So, any proportion is there. Just by normal idea, they give it. Okay. So, in mixtures show properties of all constituents present therein. So, all properties will be there. For example, if I am making a mixture with salt, water and sugar. So salt, you can also taste the sugar. Okay, so all the properties of the constituents will be seen. You can taste water also, you can taste sugar also, you can taste salt also. Okay, now during the preparation of a mixture, energy such as heat, light and electricity is neither absorbed nor evolved. So we saw that in case of compounds, either in energy or heat or light or electricity is taken from outside to inside or is given out into the environment, either taken from the environment or given to, on the environment, from into the environment. Mixtures except solutions are heterogeneous. Now, all mixtures except solutions. Solutions are generally homogeneous. Why? Because in water, most of the things any solvent, generally any solute mixes very easily, okay, in solutions. But I cannot say that in sand and water will mix in equal proportions, okay? So they are heterogeneous, but salt and water, it's a homogeneous mixture, okay? But mixtures are heterogeneous except solutions. Remember this, true or false can be given, okay? The constituents of a mixture can be separated by simple physical methods. For example, I have mixed water and salt. Now, I heat that water which is containing the salt. What will happen? Water will ultimately evaporate and go up, and the salt will be, we can get the salt back. So, by simple physical methods, we can get the constituents of the mixture back. And water can be regained by the condensation part. Okay. Now, difference between a mixture and a compound. What are the differences? Very important question which is given in this exams. Mixtures differ from compounds as follows. Mixtures except solutions are heterogeneous. Remember, solutions are homogeneous. Mixtures otherwise are always heterogeneous. Compounds are always homogeneous. In a mixture, constituents may be present in any proportion. We do not measure it. But in compound, constituent elements are present in a fixed ratio always. Okay, by volume or by mass. A mixture shows properties of its constituents. Means, as I told you, the solution of sugar, salt and water, we can all the properties of the constituents are seen, but in case of the properties of a compound, it is totally different from the compound which is formed. The constituent elements like hydrogen and oxygen, we cannot see their properties. We can see the properties of the compound as a whole, that is the water. Okay, constituents of a mixture can be separated by physical methods, and constituents of the compound cannot be separated by physical methods. Okay, we cannot separate. For example, if we heat water, what will happen? Can we get the hydrogen and oxygen gas? No, we cannot get. But if constituent of a mixture can be separated by physical methods, for example, salt, so sand and this one, water. So I just strain the sand, I will get the sand and water differently. By sedimentation also, I can get the, by physical method, I can get the sand and water separately. But in case of compound, we cannot get that. During preparation of a mixture, energy such as heat, light or electricity is neither absorbed nor involved. Very important point. No amount of heat is taken from the environment or given to the environment in case of mixture. But when a compound is prepared, some amount of heat, light or electricity might be either taken from the environment, it is absorbed, or evolved or given out into the environment. Okay. So, you see here, one more slide is left. The difference between elements, compound and mixture, very nicely it is shown here. Can you see here two elements are shown, A and B. Can you see? A and B, two types of elements are shown. And you can see that both the elements are having same type of atoms. Okay. A element is having same type of atoms. B element is having same type of atoms. So I told you that, think A is copper. So it is having same type of copper atoms. Similarly, B, if I consider oxygen, it is having same type of atoms. Okay. Mixture containing A and B, you are having, this is a homogeneous mixture. This is a heterogeneous mixture. That is, you cannot see in this homogeneous heterogeneous mixture, you can see that the white balls and the green black balls are of different numbers. They are not of same numbers. You can count and see. But in compound AB, you have the same proportion. That means the proportion is fixed. Okay. The A, for every white ball, there is a black ball in a compound. But in a mixture, for every white ball, there is no black ball. Okay. So the mixture does not have anything in fixed proportion, but in case of compound, it is in a fixed proportion always. Okay. So this is all for today's lesson, children. Hopefully you have understood, and go through the video repeatedly. In one time, if you go through the video, you will not understand anything. Go through the video twice. These are all new things for you. Go through it repeatedly, then you will understand these things. And while you are going through the video, also take help of the book. Any questions, you can ask in the when I open the settings, you can ask the questions. Okay, till then, thank you. And